Responsibility, of course, of steering the association falls on the president, any time to do it alone. They say it takes two to tango. Lasanta was a tower of strength to me and to the SLMA last year. Those of you who know both of us know that Lasanta and I had no past history whatsoever of having worked together before last year. I invited him to be the secretary because, having observed him over the years, I knew that he was the best man for the job. I knew that he had the same passion as I had to do something special for the SLMA in its 125th anniversary year. I invited, he agreed. Today, I can look back and say I was spot on. Ladies and gentlemen, let us also acknowledge, with a round of applause, the enormous contribution Dr. Lasanta Malagiri made last year to the SLMA. The enormous sacrifices he made in that process. Back to rebranding. When that one rebrands, ladies and gentlemen, one cannot go back. The SLMA, therefore, cannot go back to doing things the old-fashioned way. We have to understand the realities of the modern-day world. Firstly, we live in a corporate world. In fact, it was Professor Lalita Mendis who reminded us about it back in 2009 when she presided over the development of the first ever corporate plan of the SLMA. 4 years later, we are giving more and more emphasis to that corporate plan and are rallying the association around it with a common vision, a common mission, and a common set of objectives. Very much like the corporate world operates. Secondly, we live in a world of electronic and digital media, where communication through email, social media, and mobile devices is the norm. The SLMA is undergoing the electronic and digital transformation that is necessary to keep pace with the modern world. Finally, we live in a world where discussion and debate in the council of an association like the SLMA should center on identifying key performance indicators and strategizing to achieve them. In other words, we live in a world where professional associations have to think and work like companies to survive. There has to be planning, implementation, re-evaluation of the plans, and revised implementation, which must reach with much more determination and purpose. Since the annual general meeting on the 22nd of December 2012, in this transition period, that is exactly what the SLMA has been doing. Under the dynamic leadership, new leadership of Dr. BJC Perera, we have sat down, looked at the past, and revised our plans. A new trend, rather than the council of the previous year finishing off a job, and the new one taking on afresh in a different direction, we see continuity. And as such, today, the SLMA would break with tradition. And Dr. BJC Perera could talk about what was set in motion last year and how he plans to carry it forward, bringing in new blood and new ideas. That, ladies and gentlemen, can only make the SLMA an even stronger organization, a truly apex professional association, and perhaps in the future, even a player in the international arena. Today is Dr. Perera's day. Therefore, with those brief words, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to conclude. But before I do that, I would like to thank my wife Ruangi and the kids for their understanding and tolerance and support during the last year. Ladies and gentlemen, all of you have honored Dr. BJC Perera and me by your presence here today. Thank you. On 14th July 1947, he had his primary and secondary education at the Mazenod College, Kandana, and at St. Peter's College, Colombo. He qualified MBBS on with second class honors from the Faculty of Medicine, Colombo, in 1970. Thereafter, he went on to obtain many postgraduate qualifications, including his PhD in 1974, BCH England in 1977, MRCP UK in 1978, and MD Pediatrics Colombo in 1983. In 1993, he was elected a fellow of both the Royal Colleges of Physicians in Edinburgh and in London. In 1998, he was elected a fellow of the Royal College of Pediatrics and Child Health. The same year, he was elected a fellow of the Sri Lanka College of Pediatricians. In 2002, he was elected a fellow of the Ceylon College of Physicians. In 2007, 8, and 11, he was honored by the Royal College of Pediatrics and Child Health in the UK, the Sri Lanka College of General Practitioners, and the Postgraduate Institute of Medicine with honorary fellowships and a senior fellowship, respectively. He has served in numerous parts of the country, including at the General Hospital in Kandy, Balul, Ratnapura, Kurunagar, and Kalabopila. A member of the Board of Study in Sports Medicine and a member of the Speciality Board in Biomedical Informatics. He has a special interest in promoting publication of research work. He has been and continues to be the joint editor of the Sri Lanka Journal of Child Health from the year 2000, the joint editor of the Proceedings of the Sri Lanka College of Pediatricians Annual Scientific Congress from 1997, the editor-in-chief of the Sri Lanka Journal of Biomedical Informatics from 2010, and associate and assistant editor of the Ceylon Medical Journal from 2009, a member of the International Advisory Board of Pediatrics and Child Health, earlier part of Pediatrics, from 2001, a member of the International Review Panel of Archives of Disease in Childhood from 2003, a member of the International Review Panel of Medical Science Monitor from 2005, and a reviewer in the International Editorial Advisory Board of Scientific Journals International from 2005. He is a researcher himself, with 30 research papers in peer-reviewed index journals, 64 oral platform scientific presentations in conferences in Sri Lanka and around the world, 34 published research abstracts, 13 publications written by invitation to externally reviewed journals as well as peer-reviewed international journals, and 24 editorials in the Sri Lanka Journal of Child Health. He has contributed to 7 books as editor, chapter author, or joint author, and has delivered 8 orations and 36 guest lectures at national and international level. This work has won him 4 awards for the best paper of the Congress in various conferences, the Research Bonus Award from the President of Sri Lanka in 1999, an Outstanding Pediatrician of Asia Award awarded by the Asia Pacific Pediatrics Association in March 2007. He is a pediatrician who rose to serve the nation in its hour of need. He holds the rank of Senior Superintendent of Police in the Sri Lanka Police Reserve. He is a sportsman He was ranked 6th in the Sri Lanka Open National Tennis Rankings in 1995. He's a family man. I've been married to Sarojini for 37 years. He wants me to tell you that he was only married once. He's also the proud father of a daughter and grandfather of two lovely grandchildren. I have had the pleasure of knowing Dr. BJC Perera from my student days. And has worked closely with him for the past 5 years, both in and outside of the Sri Lanka Medical Association. You would agree with me, ladies and gentlemen. We have selected a clinician, a researcher, and most of all, a human being worthy of being the president of the Sri Lanka Medical Association to lead us this year. It gives me great pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, to invite Dr. BJC Perera to come over to receive the presidential medal and deliver his presidential address. Dr. Perera.
The immediate first president of the Sri Lanka Medical Association, the members of the Board of Trustees, past presidents, members of the Council, and members of the Sri Lanka Medical Association, and distinguished invitees. Ladies and gentlemen, I stand here in all humility, bewildered by this great honor that has been bestowed on me towards the latter part of my professional career. I'm going to talk to you, I thought, on a topic, Sri Lanka Medical Association, from there to here to eternity. It's a glorified version of past, present, and future. I thought it was inappropriate for me to talk on high-powered research or any of the other things that many people talk about, rather than things at hand that we will have to embark upon as we go along for the next year. Sri Lanka Medical Association is the oldest national organization of doctors in Asia and Australasia. It has been there now for the last 126 years. Very, very long time. It does have a wonderful legacy and a priceless heritage. There's Confucius who said, "Study the past if you would define the future." So that's exactly a little bit of what I'm doing at the moment. Indeed, the Sri Lanka Medical Association has had a glorious past. I don't think there is any doubt about it at all, and you'll see the truth of this statement as I go along. It was a great Indian statesman, Mahatma Gandhi, who said, "The small body of determined spirits, fired by an unquenchable faith in their vision, can alter the course of history." He did that. He did just that. As much as this band of men, 15 men, led by Dr. W. R. Kinsey, later Sir William Kinsey. On the 26th of February 1887, we met in the Colonial Medical Library in Marlana Road to discuss the establishment of a branch of the British Medical Association in this country. And there was the formal inauguration of the Sloan branch of British Medical Association on the 17th of December 1887, and this is the oldest institution that we now know as the Sri Lanka Medical Association. The first president was Dr. P. D. Anthonis. Dr. Kinsey declined because he was going on furlough, as they used to call it in colonial times. This association has had several name changes, as you see on the slide. It was first known as the Ceylon branch of the British Medical Association, then the Ceylon Medical Association. It was incorporated as a branch of the BMA under the Companies Act. And in 1957, we finally cut our Army Act of War from the British Medical Association. We became independent in our own right. and it was renamed by the Sri Lankan Democratic Association in 1972 when it became a democratic socialist republic. It is definitely the apex medical institution, academic institution in Sri Lanka, certainly not a trade union, quite unlike, perhaps, its grandfather, which is the British Medical Association. The membership fee in 1887 was 1 rupee per year, approximately 8 cents a month. By 1898, the membership had grown to 113, and the membership dues had increased to 4 rupees per year, 33 cents per month. And you can see where that slide came from. What? From 2012, life membership is 10,000 rupees, order membership is 2,500. We also have overseas life membership for $250. As at 2012 December, we have 3,214 life members in our association. The annual wage bill of the employees in 1901 was 150 rupees. You can see the breakdown there. The wage bill in 1980 was 29,000 odd. And in 2012, it was almost 2 million for 8 employees. And this does not include the 8 employees, does not include the council and the president and everybody who performed honorary job. So this is for the running of the wage bill for these 8 employees. You might say that we pay them pretty well, but even when you divide that, it really is reasonable, but not all that much. From its inception until the 77th year, this association had no home of its own. Then on the 24th of July 1964, Dr. Edmund Medonza Mijeram signed the legal paper of his spacious home at number 6, Mekante Road, number 7, as it was known then, to the Ceylon Medical Association. That's where we are now. Now, Dr. Vijayaram was a great, obviously a great philanthropist to have done all this. But when the obstruction to the upper airway was very severe, they had a tracheostomy and they were nursed in this clinic. No more. I think they have converted that to something else now. And it's part of World War I, if I'm not very much mistaken now. That was the real unit. Polio? And immunization covered in 2001. Again, I have gone through 3 epidemics of it, one as a medical student, one as an intern hospital, and then as a registrar. There was the polio ward as well at LRH. That's all fine. And it's in rather dilapidated state at the moment because nothing is happening, and then it's used as a kind of a storeroom for virtually antiques now. And one of those antiques is this, the iron lung that we used when children had paralysis of the respiratory muscles. These were real virtual coffins, actually. If you put a child into this, the chances of coming out of this were very remote. Because you have negative pressure being exerted, all the secretions tend to get sucked out. Sucked in to the lung, and they drown in their own secretions. And I had the misfortune of putting several children to this death coffin, knowing very well that the chances of their survival were minimal. It's not a problem anymore. The last case of polio was seen over 15 years ago. See how much we have managed. Within Nigeria, and we are on the verge of being certified as completely free or polio-free country. Measles and immunization have it. You might think measles is not a problem, but it kills children. And you can see how it has improved over the years after immunization. Malaria, we know it used to cause a lot of problems, of course. It's well under control now. There are trends in neonatal and infant mortality rates which are really gratifying, as you can see in this slide. It's come down, way down, from 140 to 1940s, around the time that 1.2 kilogram weight was around, down to sort of virtually sort of around 8 men. And this is how it has gone. Lincoln might have weighed in 300,000 divers. The world average is in blue, on top, 60 to 38. You can see how well Sri Lanka has done over the years, around somewhere around 8. Maternal mortality, mothers who die, complications, or other things around childbirth. And these are the results. 2010, Somalia is 1,000 per 100,000 livers. The answer is 35 per 100,000 livers. There are 116 countries above this rate even now, and 66 countries only below the 300 rate. Singapore is just 3 per 100,000. Lowest is Estonia at 2 per 100,000. We have some way to go, but we have done pretty well up to the present time. Literacy rate, these are things that would help in our quest towards providing better healthcare to people. And you can see how well it has improved. And earlier in the 1880s, you can see where the females were. And then now, males and females are almost equal. They're literate in this country and at a very, very high rate. Life expectancy at birth, 1946 to 2001. See how well it has improved. 2010, males were 72 years, females were 79, almost 80. The annual scientific sessions of the Sri Lanka Medical Association start from its Golden Jubilee in 1937 and is held every year. And it's really an academic extravaganza. We have a lot of foreign speakers, a lot of experts in subjects. We have presentation of local research, and sometimes even research done out of the country. Ceylon Medical Journal started the same year that the SLMA had its birth, August 1887, Volume 1, Issue 1. And up to date, it is one of the most long-standing and outstanding medical journals in Asia and Australasia. And this is the official publication, official academic publication of the Sri Lanka Medical Association. All work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. I think you have heard that sometime or the other in your lives. We have doctor's concert and start from 1976. From the 89 diagnostic sessions. And it is interesting to note that a report even appeared in the British Medical Journal in 1979 of this concert. The medical dance first was organized in the 1930s. We don't really know the proper history of this. Then Dr. Randall initiated a move which made the Sri Lanka Medical Association take this over from 1939. We've had very successful dances recently. These are just a couple over the last few years. Now I come. I delve into the past. Now I come to the present. The future, Mahatma Gandhi said, depends on what you do today. And somebody else said, faith is not knowing what the future holds, but knowing who holds the future. Last year, around the same time, we handed over the future of this association to these two. You have already heard from one of them, and on your right is Dr. Lasantamarvike of Global Fame. And now, if I may ask you to come up for this little token from the Sri Lanka Medical Association, the past president's medal. I have grown a tradition and not given it at the start because I wanted you to know what he had done. And this is what he had done. That's what they said, how to do. Increase the visibility of SLMA. Better, wider, and content private research is other institutions. Membership drive, they brought in an unprecedented number last year, 592 black members. Fund generation, well, who can match what they did? And also build a platform. They didn't know it was, at the start, they didn't know who it was, but then it was for me to continue. They took the SLMA to a newer dimension on a different wavelength. Explored many windows of opportunity and achieved a paradigm shift in the association. Unaccredited year was a cardinal year for the association. There were many academic meetings, several every month, collaborative activities for teacher programs, and a wonderful 125th year international congress, and followed up by foundation sessions in November. Increased visibility, I think he did speak about this, but he didn't get to the whole literature. Email list of over 8,000. Every time I want something sent out to far and wide, to all corners of the globe, all I have to do is to get at him. 3,000 SLMA members in this email list, but about 5,000 others. They have websites, they have email and SMS alerts. And these are some of the websites. Three, really, featured in our own. And we have a top call service through Mobitel, through the mobile phones, where the general public can ring a specified number and be patched on to a doctor to give advice over the phone. These are some of the statistics that we got from Mobitel. And you might be surprised that quite a amount, I mean, the major part of this was the conversations were in Singhalese. Then you can see how it has gone up. And quite a lot, almost 50% of the calls were people between the ages of 20 and 35. You would expect these calls to be coming from the older people, but then these are the breakdown. Then SLMA is featured in social media. You name it, almost everywhere it's there. Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, YouTube, Google+. And it was virtually an electronic blast through the whole of last year. But having said that, when you go too far down this line of electronic, turn the red city in New York into darkness and brought it to its knees. And his council members, including Lasanta, would be with me, and they have promised that. Because Pope John Paul II said the future starts today, not tomorrow. Learn from yesterday, live for today, hope for tomorrow, Albert Einstein. And Eleanor Roosevelt, the longest surviving first lady of the United States of America, said, "The future belongs to those believing the beauty of their dreams." I am hoping to ride on this wave that has been created last year. And I hope my council and the other members of the association will join me in riding this wave. As he said, quite rightly, we are only going to continue in the same step that he has started, or they have started. And then, there are some interesting thoughts on this. Life expectancy at birth, 1946-1991, you can see how much it has gone up. But then, the birth rate is only 17 per 1,000 population, and the death rate is just about 6. Not enough people are dying. So, and do I have all these problems? Fertility rate has been halved. So there aren't enough children coming out either. And the implication of this is in the age pyramids. 1991, 2006, 2026, and 2056. The predictions. You can see it's getting better at the top. The pyramid has virtually been having word now. These were the key problems that I showed you earlier in years gone by. These are going to be replaced by a new set. Things like obesity, diabetes, arthritis, high blood pressure, heart attacks, strokes, road traffic crashes, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, malignancies, non-infectious liver and kidney diseases, old age, osteoporosis, dementia. These have already taken over, I think, some of the, look at the disease burden. Non-communicable diseases. The Ministry of Health has declared this year as the year of non-communicable diseases. About 15,000 to 20,000 new cases of cancer every year. Plus, only 37,000 to 100,000 in 1985. Which have doubled in 2005, and it accounted for 3,500 hospital deaths in 2007. And the Honourable Minister of Health is noted to have said around 50% die of strokes every day in the country. And Professor Chandra, who works in, who is the head of the European project of the Sri Lanka Medical Association, is used with diabetes like another non-communicable diseases, the aging population was only 9.2% in 2001, and 2031 is predicted to be 20.7%. So with that, with the high prevalence of non-communicable diseases, we are going to have increasing number of living with disabilities, the need for long-term care, mental health problems, and also emergency situations with various types of natural disasters and catastrophes. The NCDs, the non-communicable diseases, account for significant morbidity and mortality. In 2011, the Ministry of Health spent all these large amounts of money on some of these non-communicable diseases. And quite a lot of them are really quite under. And this cost is only increased. There will be an increasing burden for the country. As we go along, the youth are the adults of tomorrow. There are risky behaviors that they are engaged in. Several stress induced manifestations, unhealthy food habits, lack of exercise, substance abuse, unsafe sexual behavior, and various types of mental illness, which are going to have an impact on population later on in life. Trends in low birth weight. It has been reduced, but not reduced enough. So we're going to have continuing problems with low birth weight babies. They are likely to have all kinds of problems. And these are the biggest average urban 11.6 rural 70.6, and the SS sector is traveling. It's 20% of babies born are underweight. And there are, to add to all this, there are the impact of environmental changes on the health of the population. Our plans are to consolidate the gains and take the robust institution from strength to strength. The theme for this year is towards enhancement of quality and safety in healthcare. So these are some of the things that we have planned. To increase membership again and to do a further added value to the membership. We have our provincial meetings and annual scientific congresses already been arranged from the 10th to the 13th of July this year. Together with the health walk and run that they started last year, we're trying to make this a national health walk and run with the conference of the ministry. We have to get their conference to do this. Then the foundation sessions we've already arranged in Anuradhapura. This is an interesting thing because we went for an ordinary provincial meeting last year in Anuradhapura, and I got a little late to go there in the morning. And before I reached that place, Vajra had already pledged that he would have a foundation session there. And it was cut and dry for me. The least I could do was to accept it. And I like that place. I like the people. I like the support we have. And I'm sure we have very successful foundation sessions. As for the one about annual sign in Congress, I've already had, I've already arranged for the incoming president of the British Medical Association to be our chief guest. I won't tell you who it is. It is, at the current moment, the president is a baroness, but the one who's coming in is a knight. Electronic and media promotion messages, increasing the visibility, perhaps media workshops, database of researchers if possible, electronic continuing personal development and public health education, already arranged radio talks to views on health to by courtesy of Party Manasi Khadu through the SLDC. This will come at 6:30 in the evening every Monday. And next Wednesday, three appointments are going to make their recordings and they will come, so this will be through the SLMA, perhaps from now onwards. And there are other projects based on the corporate plan that you already saw and why are any there too. We have already arranged to pick the chair for the different level at the SLMA, which is very kindly donated by the family of the Dr. Stella Silva. That will be installed next week, which is a damn need, a real necessity, because it's a huge problem for these people to get up to our auditorium. And we're hoping to attract the corporate sector to be part of the SLMA, especially based on the theme of quality and safety. And we already have some people who have pledged their support from the corporate sector in this venture over the last 3-4 days. We at the SLMA would work on the set C's: cooperation, coordination, collaboration, consultation, communication, and consensus. The greatest of all time said, "Do not count the days, make the days come." Actually, he thought he was the greatest of all time. There is no telling, somebody has said, there is no telling how many miles you will have to run by chasing a dream, and we will run those minds. Time is the most precious treasure that we have, because it is limited. We can produce more money, but not more time. When we dedicate time to a cause, we are doing something that we can never recover. The best gift you can give the SLMA is your time. I said, the six C's, one for the answer is communication. M-Health, that's short form of mobile health. We know many use mobile devices, spray, laptops, tablets, smartphones, and all kinds of things. And also, especially the ladies I was told, and their research evidence for this, use SMS and other electronic communication modalities. Most use personal devices that work, we all do actually. Health messages through these devices would get through to very many people. And towards that end, this is still in the trial stage. SMS, just type follow SMS online and send you 40404, 25 cents for the SMS after the everything is free. And all the SMS will be sent automatically at no further cost. This is free service sent through Facebook and Twitter. And anytime you want to get out of the news of getting all kinds of things from the SMS, and we have set the ball rolling and we are having an initial speech draft program, which is a prelude to the starting of Toastmasters Club from the 6th of February. Communications, the book. We have produced a book, and I'm very pleased to tell you that it's my very first official duty. I must tell you how this came about. Last year on International Down Syndrome Day, we had a session to increase awareness about Down syndrome and the disabilities associated with it. And Wajra had something or the other to do at that time. And he asked me to share this. And all kinds of problems were highlighted, not only by the doctors, but also by some parents who had undergone tremendous hardships with Vijay Bachchan. And in a weak moment, I promised one of those people that within 6 months from that day, that we would produce a booklet which would give guidelines, proper guidelines for communication to healthcare personnel. And this request was made by one of the speakers at that time, Mr. Chanaka Diselva, attorney at law. Chanaka, you're there somewhere. Yes, Chanaka. Now, because this was originated from your idea to launch this book, I would like you to come up and launch it by doing the first copy, presenting the first copy to our immediate Power President, Professor Vajra Jisanaya. So, please ask you to come up and do the honors for us. That's the book. Ladies and gentlemen, we need to join hands, members and others, with the SLMA to take it, perhaps, if possible, to even greater heights. We need to put our resources. At least this little lot, who I shall know there, I'm sure, will be with me in this endeavor. I have tried to give you some idea, ladies and gentlemen, of what it has been like, what it is now, and what we hope it will be in the future for the Sri Lanka Medical Association. Trust takes years to build, and the trust the membership and the medical fraternity has placed on me is immense by letting me this August position. I also know that it takes only seconds to break this trust, and once broken, it's forever to repair, if at all it could ever be repaired. So I give you my pledge that I'm not likely to break this trust that has been placed in me, placed on me, by electing me to the highest position of the Apex Medical Association of Sri Lanka. Ladies and gentlemen, I take your leave by saying I have won, may you live long with the national flag in hand. Thank you for your patience.
Hats off to our team. Professors Hemanta Sena Nayaka, Prashanta Abhyasena, and Saroshita Sena, Doctors Anuruddha Palaniya, Samir Ratna, and Vice Khalifa, for completing this task on time. And also our sincere thanks are extended to Mr. Mahanamada Dakregama from SMS Harrison for his generous support to print this booklet. I'm sure it's going to have a lasting impact on the future of the healthcare workers. Dr. BJC Perera, the conductor of the orchestra. He has been instrumental in organizing tonight's concert in this grand style. Therefore, sir, I think it's my prime duty on behalf of the members of the council to thank you for always initiating and doing things in style. Also, I would like to thank the two vice presidents and the office bearers and all the other council members who contributed to this event in every possible way. My thanks goes to Mr. Sima Fernando and his team from Astron Private Limited for sponsoring this event. Thank you for your generosity. Staff at the HND Towers were always obliging and they requested finance anything. Thank you very much. As always, there are a lot of reservoirs behind the curtains. The official staff, under the leadership of Mr. Raj Singh,